Penguin Random House Audio presents Billion Dollar Burger, Inside Big Tech's Race for the Future of Food. This is the author, Chase Purdy. To My Mother. Author's note. Throughout this book, I use the term cell-cultured meat, or cultured meat, because it is a scientifically accurate descriptor that reflects how the product is made. Even still, scientists, entrepreneurs, and regulators have not yet unified around a single term. Prologue. It's rare, but every now and again, the biggest solution is incredibly, incredibly small. Everyone sitting here with bated breath is dying to see what's underneath, says Nina Hossain, a British television personality. It's August 2013. She's on a brightly lit stage with four others. She turns to Dr. Mark Post on her left, who has flown to London from Central Europe. He's staring down at the big desk before him, at a silver platter covered by a silver dome. So can you do the honors and lift the lid on your creation? It was a make-or-break moment. Proof that the concept could be tugged from the imagination and into reality, and maybe someone rich would see it. It's, well, that's what we need, it's money, a scientist on Post's team would later say. And I don't care who it is, if it's Bill Gates or Paul McCartney or whatever, but someone to really see, literally see, that there's a future behind this process. Post reached down and lifted the lid. Cameras in the room zoom tightly onto a little petri dish filled with pink ground beef. Only this wasn't ordinary beef. It was grown in Post's laboratory, painstakingly cultured from microscopic cells that had been collected from a living cow. A cow that was still alive, not needing to be slaughtered for the sake of Post's burger. The 5-ounce patty cost $330,000 to produce. Chef Richard McEwen cooked the burger on stage. Sitting next to Post were Hani Rutzler, a food scientist, and Josh Schoenwald, a food writer, who craned their necks to watch the burger sizzle in a searing hot frying pan. McEwen served it up next to a lettuce leaf, a bun, and some tomato slices. Rutzler sliced into the burger. She pricked it with a fork, bringing it up close to her face to catch its aroma and inspect it closely. Then she took a bite, chewing slowly. I was expecting the texture to be more soft, she said. There is quite some intense taste. It's close to meat. But it's not that juicy. The consistency is perfect, but I miss salt and pepper. Then Schoenwald did the same. The mouthfeel is like meat, he said. I miss the fat. There's a leanness to it, but the general bite feels like a hamburger. The BBC, the New York Times, the Telegraph, and National Public Radio dispatched stories. Twitter and Reddit flared up. In the face of a changing climate, growing concerns about animal welfare, antibiotic resistance, and global hunger, maybe, just maybe, we could take something small and use it to make big steps towards reshaping animal agriculture, a system that is responsible for about 14% of the globe's greenhouse gas emissions, and the yearly slaughter of some 65 billion animals, not including fish. Triumphant at the success of his showcase, Mark Post packed up and flew back home to the Netherlands. He returned to his Maastricht University laboratory, where he got back to work, quietly ushering his expensive little burger into its next phase. And then nothing. Silence. A couple years ticked by, and nobody heard much more about cell-cultured meat. Meanwhile, the general public began to catch wind of high-tech plant-based burgers made by the likes of Beyond Meat and Impossible Foods, imitation meat that put traditional garden-variety black bean patties to shame as they were marched into grocery stores and showed up on the menus of high-end restaurants, like David Chang's Momofuku Nishi in New York's moneyed Chelsea neighborhood, and eventually fast food chains as commonplace as Burger King. But the science didn't stop. And slowly, cultured meat began to creep back into the public consciousness. Post founded his own company and called it Mosa Meat. In 2015, Uma Valetti followed suit and founded Bay Area-based Memphis Meats. Yuki Hanyu started Tokyo-based Integriculture. Ido Savir founded Israel-based Supermeat. Then Finless Foods, Just, and Aleph Farms announced their own laboratories a year later, followed by Mission Barns and Future Meat Technologies a year after that. Slowly, stories and photos have started trickling out from these laboratories, showing chicken tenders, bluefin tuna, burgers, foie gras, steaks, and nuggets. Investment in these companies is picking up, too. Since 2015, more than $100 million has been invested in cell-cultured meat by venture capitalists and existing food giants, with the number and size of deals increasing every year. Buoyed by venture capital and billionaire investors looking to overturn the multi-billion-dollar meat industry, these startups are in an edible space race to get cell-cultured meat to market first. It's a complicated problem. First, they need to devise a way to scale cell culture technology at a reasonable cost. In 2013, it was priced at $1.2 million per pound. Now it's hovering around $50 per pound, a precipitous drop as the technologists behind it have pushed the science to new heights. Then they need to hack a path forward through Byzantine regulations designed around the needs and desires of the trillion-dollar meat industry. Against that kind of economic power, even the best-funded startups look like lightweights. But one of these companies claims it'll beat everyone else to the finish line. Josh Tetrick is a vegan activist and the CEO of San Francisco-based Just. He aims to reshuffle how humans around the world think about the meat they consume, where it comes from, and how it's made. And he has one big advantage over his competition. He's the only one who actually knows how to run a food company. Since 2011, he's successfully rolled out a line of vegan condiments, vegan cookie doughs, and a popular liquid egg alternative made from mung beans. Those have been adopted globally by stores and restaurants. He has already established relationships up and down the food supply chain and the industry know-how to more easily get future food products onto the market, where they'll go head-to-head with the conventional meats we've always known. And he's investing, heavily, in the science behind cell-cultured meat, building an on-site laboratory with a staff of about a dozen scientists who are experts in this new field. The science is complex. The $1.8 trillion meat market is hyper-competitive. The stakes are high. If he messes up, it could scramble the rollout of one of the most promising answers to the climate crisis yet. But if he succeeds, it could begin a revolution. Chapter 1, Digging In. I slide my pen and notepad to the side. It's a sunny afternoon in 2018. Scooting my metal stool up to the edge of a tabletop in Just's impressive food laboratory, I peer around me. This thing I'm waiting to see is supposed to be the powder keg that sets off a culinary shift. Much talked about, rarely seen, and almost never tasted. The company's headquarters sits in the heart of San Francisco's Mission District, at the corner of 16th and Folsom Streets. It's two stories tall and sprawls across 98,000 square feet of space, all enclosed behind thick, pinkish-beige walls that once housed the Joseph Schmidt Confections Chocolate Factory and later a Disney Pixar studio. Just has married the building's food and technology pasts. Each day, more than 100 employees show up to work here. They enter through a front door of frosted glass, covered with the blemishes of bygone years, and surrounded by a smudged golden frame. The entryway leads up a flight of black stairs, down a carpeted hallway past a company break room, well-stocked, of course, with avocados and LaCroix-flavored seltzers, and then finally into the company's cavernous nerve center. The floors are made of slick concrete, the walls are white, and dozens of long wooden desks stretched across the center of a room that's bathed in natural light, pouring through a wall of tall windows. All around me, teams of scientists are using expensive lab equipment to dive deep into the inner lives of plants, exploring the tiny components that make them unique in an effort to figure out how they can be used to make new types of food. What plant proteins can work as emulsifiers? Which ones can withstand stovetop heat? In a
corner of the lab. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.